It's February 15th, 2017. We are interviewing Lewis MacAdams from the Friends of the Los Angeles River. The interviewer is Jenifer Palmer-Lacy, cameraman Marco Larson, and also present Khoi and Michael Masterson.
Okay.
Take it, Jenifer.
Okay. So I was going over your material, and you came here from Texas.
Indirectly.
And 1980.
I didn't actually come in 1980. I lived in the 1970s in San Francisco. And
oh, did you? Okay.
Around Marin County. So I spent 10 years in Bolinas before I moved to L.A. But I did live in L.A. in San Francisco. In
right, right. Did quite a bit of interesting work in San Francisco. You've always been politically active.
Yeah, always.
And in poetry as well.
I ran the Poetry Center at San Francisco State for several years.
How long were you there?
I ran the Poetry Center for 3 years.
Okay. And you were also in New Mexico?
Yeah. I won the World Heavyweight Poetry Championship, which doesn't exist anymore. If you see these bronze boxing gloves on industrial strength, that's what you got when you won the World Heavyweight Poetry bout. Be careful if you pick it up because it weighs about 15 pounds. One person did break his toe because he didn't realize how heavy it was and he dropped it.
All right.
Be careful. I mean, you can still find to touch it, but it's just heavy, you know.
Whoa.
It's bronze, solid bronze.
Heavy. So that was in Taos?
Taos, yeah, the World Heavyweight Poetry Bout. There was a poetry collective in Taos that organized it every year for about 15 years. And it was really, and they'd have a festival around it, and there was workshops, and you know, people really enjoyed it. It's a small, funky town, so 1,000 people showed up, all drunk. All of people were betting on the bout. It was another way of looking at poetry, and the poetry audience, it was the fun way.
Yeah, there was also, for a while, at the Midnight Special in Santa Monica, there were contests like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's
participated in.
I never did one in Santa Monica.
Yeah, okay.
I never really was enthralled with a lot of poetry, at least especially in L.A., is kind of based around rabble-rousing, and usually in the best sense of the word, but it seemed like, I just felt like I was too old for that sort of thing. You got to keep it fresh.
Right. And you do have a couple of books out. One of them is about the river, poetry about the river.
Well, yes, I guess you could say that, yeah. Not so much about the river as of the river.
That was a quote from it at the River Center where the Santa Monica Mountains people meet in Lowry Center, and there was a quote from
that's our office, Friends of Los Angeles River's office is in that same building.
How did you get started going to the river as an inspiration?
Because it was there. And it sort of grew out of an inability to think of to focus on any one big project. And I wanted to create a project that would last really a long time. And because at that point, performance art was young. And one of the ways that I was interested in performance art was like how long the performance would last. And so I thought, finally, 40 years is about, that's a pretty long work, you know, so.
Right.
You know, and so far we're 32 years into it. I hope I can stay standing upright for the last 8 years, but so far so good.
Yeah. It's a good run. When did you When did the Grand Limpieza start? The cleanup of the river that they have in the spring?
We started that. It started about, what is it? It's like, it's probably about 20-some years ago. Mm-hmm. I'm really bad about dates and things because it's all just sort of flows around and stops at certain places. But the first year I called for 10,000 people to show up, and about 10 people actually showed up. But it was we looked at it as a complete success, of course, because you have to. And but then this last year we had approximately 9,000 people at the cleanup, so we may be able to make our goal, the goal that which people laughed at me for completely. This summer, we'll see. It's definitely attainable now. Mm-hmm. But it was a cleanup, and God knows the river appreciated it. But it was also really just a gathering moment, a chance. I mean, FoLAR is about community, and one of the basic ways you form a community is around work. If a community isn't formed around work, it's a suspect in my mind, in my eyes. But the cleanup was about picking up the trash, but it was even more about being part of the trash, I guess. I used to worry that we were going to run out of garbage because we've gotten to the point where we clean up so much, but there seems to be enough garbage to go around, so...
And was that totally your idea to have the Grand Limpieza?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
For the first year, because none of the central people speak decent Spanish, and so we called it Grand. We had the wrong title on the T-shirts, and that was embarrassing. The next year we got it right. So. And we still have a different artist to do each year, and have done some really wonderful. Kim Abeles, I don't know if you know Kim's work. Kim's did the T-shirt one year. One woman named Mason is a really really good artist. But we've sort of for the last few years, it's been a woman named Christian Kasperkovitz who lives in Topanga, and she's done the design for the T-shirts and our tote bags. We give them away. We can't figure out how not to give them away because they're so nice. People will buy them, but if you don't have them, it doesn't help to buy them if they don't exist. So.
Well, and they it's kind of like a thank you for showing up and cleaning the river.
Yeah, no, it's a good thing, and we've been able to do it for free for years and years. But as it gets bigger and bigger. It's harder and harder to not raise the money because we usually get all the stuff directly from T-shirt manufacturers, and but the logistics of it are increasingly difficult, especially in places like Frogtown and Atwater.
Right, and that's grown up too. There used to not be any access to the river from there. Everything was chained off unless you wanted to wire cut like you did.
Yeah,
you couldn't get in there.
Yep, it was. There were so many logistic problems. Now there are different kinds, but there's still, like parking is becoming a real problem for that morning of the cleanup. Mm. But it's a good thing. People want to help, and they do, and people get a lot out of it and enjoy it. But then we're starting to get people complaining that there's too many cars on their street.
Oh, that's always a problem down there. So when is it coming? It's in April?
Do you have any ideas? Probably it's in
I know you can. It's always on the website, I think you're doing three different weekends again for different sections.
Three different days, but every section has stuff inside it. So it's we have it. It's probably at 10 sites, 12 sites now. Mm. I mean, I'm not kidding. I was really worried for a couple of years that we were running out of garbage, but. Human nature being what it is, it doesn't seem... I had this whole paranoid, pure paranoia that it, we'd have to go around to dumpsters and like get the trash out. It would be like Easter, except in reverse. Yeah,
yeah. Sprinkle trash together.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. People running around picking up trash.
It gets pretty dang clean. I was at the Burbank one last time, and I was getting underneath the overpasses trying to find things because they got it pretty clean.
I think we will hit a limit. It's not in every site, because some sites do the styles that. But like Burbank and like Glendale and the people you would normally think of as cleaner uppers are out there.
So you lived in Silver Lake. You were on Hidalgo Street. And when that was that?
It's all wrapped up with divorce, you know. So I can't even remember. Let's see, that would be 1986 when Gary Snyder, the great poet, came. He and I, he's been a mentor of mine for me for a long, long time. And I knew he was coming. I just started Friends of Los Angeles River. And I think we'd already done the first cleanup, I'm not sure, but he was going to do a reading at the LA Theater Center downtown, and I sent him a note and asked if he'd come to my then wife and I's house, and read poems. The reading at the theater center was in the evening, and we asked if he would come to our house in the afternoon. It was like a Sunday afternoon to read poems at our place, and enough people showed up that we could afford to buy bumper stickers. And so we had a bumper sticker, and we had a stationery. So, you know, that's all, I figured that was all you needed, you know, the bumper sticker and stationery. And Gary did. He did a wonderful reading, and then that night at the LA Theater Center, I was there, and he said to the audience, he said, "This afternoon, and there was like 1,000 people there. It was a big, really big crowd, and he said that today I went to the first meeting of Friends of the Los Angeles River." And everybody started laughing, and he goes, "Don't laugh." So that's when people are always saying, "When does FoLAR start?" And you know, I have enough alternative universes that it can, depending upon what I want to say, I can say. You know, and that Gary came through for us in a big way, and he's still around preaching efficiency and taking care of business. The last time I saw him, I had breakfast with him a couple of years ago, and he was here to give a reading, I think at USC actually, and we were finished breakfast. We were walking back to his car, and this was before Uber, and he said, "How's that poem going? The river poem that you've been working on for so long?" And I just started complaining about how hard it was to raise money for this, and how much work it took to do that, and I was whining and whining. And he just looked at his watch and looked at me, and it's like time's a running, bro. So, what else?
Oh, that's great. And so you had the reading actually in your house?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. On the deck, actually. It made it seem like a large crowd, but there was only, there were 10 people, 12 people, something like that.
Uh-huh.
One of whom was a woman named, what's her name? She was Abby Hoffman's widow, the guy that started Abby's, and his son, America. Abby was a natural-born shit disturber. He's pissed off many, many people, but I was really proud that he was, because he was underground, so he would only kind of like be very careful about where he went, and people appreciated that.
Yeah, really. I remember remember that. Yeah. So you lived on the same street with Rupert Pohl and Anaïs Nin?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
She wasn't still around then.
No, she was gone.
But he had a Japanese girlfriend that he lived with.
Yes.
And the house was designed by Eric Wright. But you couldn't see it from the street.
Right.
It was
right
way back in the back.
I went down there one day. It was the only time I was ever actually in the house. And it was in terrible shape, you know. It was just structurally, ceilings falling through. It was just really, I don't know, I haven't been living over there for a long time, but at that point, he was talking about a foundation, some sort of Anaïs Nin foundation.
Right. It was an Anaïs Nin foundation, and people were doing biographies. Mm-hmm. They would come and interview him.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
Oh, really? That's great.
Neighborhood stuff.
Yeah, I just knew him because he was an elegant dude who would take a walk with his weird little dog and stop by and sit on a rock and read the New York Times.
Yeah.
I always thought that was a good way to spend your coffee drinking hour.
So back then in Silver Lake, was it really bohemian, like they say? Did you feel like you were in the midst of a...
I feel like I lived there before it got gentrified, and then it got ungentrified, and so I was there so far for like three so-called movements, but it didn't have anything. It was stuff I kind of wanted to get away from, you know. So when I was living in Northern California, I was really active, really political, poetry, political. And I always been political for my entire adult life. And when I moved to Silver Lake, the last thing I really wanted, Friends of Los Angeles River was coming into existence, and I didn't know how much of my time and space it was going to take, but it's taken most of my time and space. So I keep friendly relations with as many people as I can in terms of poetry, but you know, I don't feel pressed to be the conductor of any sort of symphony or, you know, so I just do it for the poetry, you know, and if people like it, well, that's great.
Yeah.
And if they don't, that's fine too, because I'm the world heavyweight poetry champion. And you have to do what I say now.
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead.
Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit about that, just the beginning of the Friends of the Los Angeles River, kind of how the genesis of it, how it started, and kind of who was with you, and a little bit about the creation of it?
Okay. It's funny. We're working on this coffee table book about the river and about Friends of the Los Angeles River, and one of the people who's central to it is this, the lady who's sitting quietly over there and has heard it all before. Alex is her name, and she's just part of the collective of the production collective, I guess you say, for this project. And I was just retelling the story of the founding of the Friends of the Los Angeles River yesterday evening. And the story, the children sit on Grandpa's knee, and I'll tell you the story of the founding of Friends of the Los Angeles River. I've been involved in water politics in Marin County and Bolinas, and it formed an organization that stopped a big Army Corps of Engineers project to dump raw sewage into the San Francisco Bay at that time. And we stopped it, and this was in Bolinas in the 1970s. And when I got to LA, I started to see this. What I'd been doing, all these works, which were considered by me anyway as performance art. I mean, it was a time when poetry in LA had this component of, like, you just didn't read from a podium. You tore the sucker out of the wall, you know. And I I hadn't written journalism hardly at all before that. And when I got to LA, this sort of combination idea of performance art and LA kind of came together to create this this event. There was a series of three events unfolding, which were genuinely hated by people that saw it was there. I mean, people didn't think it was art, and didn't think it was poetry, and didn't think it was anything. But it was a situation where I didn't mind that at all, because it was about the people that were there. They were witnesses. They were an audience. They were part of the creation itself. And we walked. In those days, there was much less water in the river because it was all all recycled water. And there hadn't once you had the recycled water in there, everything just started to grow by itself. And so I had been thinking about doing something. It's really hard to explain this in a clear way, because it was the furthest thing, clarity was the furthest thing from my mind. And it was just about taking a walk up the river, and at that point, you know, there was nobody around unless they were collecting aluminum cans, basically. And there was no bike path, there was really nothing except a sort of a vision of human hell. And because it was the most fucked up place, I figured it would be the most difficult to, like I said, sort of yin-yang idea. You know, once you get all the way out with a yang, then it starts to become yin. And so I was thinking about stuff like that at that time. And I asked the river if we could speak for it, and the river didn't say no, so we figured that was a yes. And you know, and that then telescope the next 5 or 6 years when I realized at first I thought all I was going to have to do was convince people that the river could be a better place. And I then realized over a period of painful reflection that first I had to convince people that there was an LA River. And that took a few years. And, you know, I mean, all this stuff is sort of telescoped, you know, through time. And it's, I mean, FoLAR is a 40-year project, or a 40-year artwork. And so, and I was trying to think about why I chose 40 years, and there were several reasons, but one of them was that I wanted to just give people a sense of not to worry. This isn't going to come storming upstream and take away your property values. And, you know, eventually people just laughed, and that was a good thing too, because when you laugh, generally speaking, you're not threatened so much. And so that non-threatening attitude about it was really important, I think, because otherwise, you know, people would be like, what about that? What? You know, it was just been, we wouldn't have had any audience at all. We didn't have any audience at all. But I could feel that there was going to be an audience when, you know, it's like I said, the door will be open when you get there. So, and that became basically the operating principle, you know, and just not quitting, you know, and understand there was nothing to quit to. You know, if FoLAR had gone downhill, no one would have noticed. And so that was probably one of the things that made me stay with it, you know, was that sense of, you know, being part of creating a collective. You know, so, which is, you know, I personally don't like to work alone. You know, so if other people didn't like to work alone, then that's one of the reasons to work with other people. So we did, and do. And FoLAR is a really is a wonderful imaginary organization. I mean, it's imaginary in the sense that you have to use your imagination, you know, to see it.
How is it funded?
Every other way release. You know, sometimes we have grants, sometimes we have individual donors, sometimes we have people that give more money. I mean, we have basically right now about 7 or 8 employees, full-time employees. And some of them are paid out of different kinds of grants. Some of them are paid by, there's a Korean-American company called Miss Me, which does denim, and they have given us significant amounts, and we were able to give the city to $1 million that we raised from them to pay off the Corps of Engineers so they could finish this project. And I had some doubts about working with the Corps because I always hated them so much, but being able to give the city $1 million was definitely funny. It was very ironies all over the place. You know, we ran out of money, so we don't have to worry about that. And right now we have a mix of sponsors, and the river cleanup will make, if the good Lord's willing, we'll probably make, I don't know, net $50,000, people giving us $1, $2, right. $5. It's pretty grassroots. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't wear that as a badge of anything. I mean, I think if we're doing something really interesting, it's trying to create a collective that includes the four-legged ones and the two-leggeds and all the creatures of that the river belongs to.
Sure.
And that's a hard thing to remember. But I mean, we do this thing every Saturday night in the summertime, which is called the Frog Spot, which is companies give us pizzas to give away and beer and wine. And people really enjoy it. I mean, it's just sitting on the bank of the river, watching the moon go up, come up. Can't get much better than that. It's having three bands every Saturday night and playing for free because they love the vibe too.
Yeah, that's great. Well, you just stepped down recently as executive director.
Yeah. I would say I stepped up.
So in the 40-year plan, where are we?
We're 32.
And what do you see for the next 8 years then for the Friends of the River?
To figure that out, I have had to consult Moses, Martin Luther King, Cesar, Chavez. I personally, I mean, we don't have like a campaign going to raise money, but I'd like for us to have our own space that the river owns, the River Center owns. That would, if we could accomplish something in the physical world, that would be it. But this book is moving towards happening. The coffee table book, which we don't have a name for yet. I would like, we do a lot of education work, and we have something called the River Rover, which is a big, like a Fritos van, full of, they call them step vans, and one's been converted into a mobile classroom. And we go up and down the river on schools, visit on Saturdays, do a lot with thousands of people. I've seen or been part of stuff happening at the River Rover and the Frog Spot. Two events really that are sponsored by this Korean American Association, Miss Me. And let's see, we had a huge grant a couple of years ago from the Department of the Interior for $400,000 to expand all our classroom activities, and you know, so it's a thousand here, a thousand there, and
yeah,
you know, making it up as we go along.
Do you have a question?
So are you still basically located in the River Center mm-hmm. at Lowry?
Yeah, Lowry's.
Do you have to pay rent there?
Yeah, we pay rent. We don't. It's pretty nominal. I mean, I'm not sure what it is. It's always going up a little bit, but you know, $500-$600 a month. I mean, there have been months where we haven't really made it, but at this point, well, we're not socially solvent.
Well, and you had some big fun. You had two big fundraisers. The Fandangos.
This year we did that. This was an unusual year because I was stepping up, and we wanted to do a sort of ritual passage, which I think we accomplished. It was kind of but it was also a party. You know,
it was a party.
Oh, you were there?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. That's great.
Yeah, that was great. And Moby played. I didn't know he was such a good guitar player.
I didn't know. I don't know his work hardly at all, but he was wonderful to work with. And the gospel choir that we put
mm-hmm,
together.
The gospel
choir.
It was a great night.
Yeah, I know. It was. In the previous one, we'd done two before that, and in a very different way. They were really great. I mean, one of them, Mayor Garcetti, wrote a song for me for my birthday, and the band played. And that was cool. And you know, it's just a party, a gathering place, and a fundraiser. We didn't raise as much in any of those years. We didn't raise as much as I wish we had, but we just got into the party aspect. We got too far into the party. But it was a hell of a ball. All of them, all three so far have been very different from one another. And that area is so interesting now that we're on First Street on the east side of the river. You know, that's going to be a problem. We're going to be pricing ourselves out of the market once again.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But I'm glad I'm actually happy that you were there, because it was, you know, I mean, most environmental groups don't go to all the trouble to put together a party like we've done. And it's well worth doing, because it brings people together, you know, in a sort of fundamental, your money or your life sort of way.
Yeah, you had art exhibits, a photography of the river.
Well, Peter Bennett is one of those guys.
Oh, he was. Oh, he's the person who did your picture.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. It just had all different kinds of media in it.
Yeah. Yeah, we try to do that. And M.K. O'Connell, who's the chairman of the board of FoLAR now, is a really, he gets it. He's completely, he's not only gets it, he is it. I mean, he's got young kids, and he's really a community guy. He's got a great energy and super positive. And, you know, that's the reason to be doing it, you know, just creating a community, an evolutionary community. Which I have no doubt will be able to sustain and grow.
I have a question about this poster here. What happened to Kerouac?
What happened? So what happened to him?
Yeah, well, just can you tell us about that? It's a documentary, right?
Yeah.
You did, so maybe a little bit about that.
Well, it was, I mean, I was been influenced by Jack Kerouac's work, like most people of my generation, etc. And these guys were making a documentary, but they couldn't. They were too out to lunch to finish it, and so they brought me in because they knew I knew a lot about the era and the moment. And I eventually ended up co-producing it and doing all the interviews and. You know, I didn't sign on for any of that stuff. I was just, but I knew the stuff and the energy to make it happen too. So, you know, and I mean, when I was in high school, I used to write Kerouac letters, you know, about how good, great we are, looking forward to meeting you and all this.
Did he answer them?
No, he never answered. You know, and then years and years later, when we were doing this, I realized, you know, that he was a complete made-up character by myself. He was actually at that time living with his mother in a trailer in Florida, you know, almost ready to die of alcoholic poisoning, classic alky death. Wow. And the film starts it when he dies, and then goes up to where he was reborn into this conference. Because a lot of it was shot at the 25th anniversary of the publication of On the Road. There was a conference. And so we put that together for as much as we could have. But like I said earlier, we had raising the money took 5 years after we shot it. We shot it, it was easy, but making money to edit it was another level of intensity. But it was really an attempt to answer that question: what happened here? Like, what happened? Well, you know, here's this guy who got what he wanted, and look what happened. You know, because mm-hmm. I mean, he just was a pathetic. There's that picture of him, that sort of bleary-eyed picture. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, the way that we saw him. But you know, but it's a. I mean, every one of the heroes of the Beat Generation is in this movie.
I see that.
And most of them were given it their best shot. Mm-hmm. And especially a guy like Gregory Corso, who was sort of the fourth. There were really only four guys that were beatniks, and they were, what that meant was highly personal. Mm-hmm. You know, because the truth was he was this great writer who just went down, you know, in the powers of media, or, you know, he thought that's what he wanted, but he turned out that's not what he got. But it's worth seeing. I really think it's a good film. It's a cautionary tale about fame and poetry. And that's sort of, in a way, really, that's why one of the weird little surprises when we made this thing was I realized people were remembering it as what happened to Kerouac, rather than, you know, asking it as a question, because we were really trying to find the real answer. How did this guy get what he wanted? And then it was, you know, it just destroyed him. And, you know, so then I was really trying to, that title really mattered, because it allowed me to sort of ask for the big questions. Mm-hmm. You know, with Kerouac, he wrote 12 books in 6 years. Mm. Not too many people can work at that prolific rate without destroying themselves.
And you also wrote a book about the Beats. Is that right?
Mm. Well, not directly. I've written two or three things sort of indirectly. Mm. I mean, I certainly was, I mean, that was my tragedy. I was too young to be a beatnik and too old to be a hippie. I've never gotten over that.
Yeah. And was Gary Snyder involved in this? Because he's Jaffe Smith.
Jaffe Ryder.
Did you talk to him at all about mm-hmm. Kerouac?
Yeah. Gary was very positive. He was a welcome part of this film, and it was great. I got to see him up close, and Gary's an amazing character, and he was one of the characters. But I mean, Gary was never jive. But guys like Gary was jive from the day he was born. He was born to be jive. But, you know, they're all there, you know, and now the only ones left, Gary's alive, and he seems to, I haven't seen him in a couple of years, but he seems to be thriving, and,
Ferlinghetti.
Ferlinghetti, There's three, because McClure is still alive. And my brother Getty, McClure, and Gary. A trio, I was actually just thinking about it today, is it might be time to start reeling in the years on this one, you know, sort of closing down the beatnik shop.
Wow.
I mean, these are my heroes, you know.
Well, it's amazing that you've been able to keep the momentum going. You had a newsletter for quite a while that was sent out to all of your...
The Kerouac or FoLAR?
For Friends of LA River.
Yeah, we do mostly online. We try really hard to have that constituency active, because that gives us political power. And so, which is one of the things that, you know, we have to have to do the work we need to do. And, you know, we're not, it's not like we're, I mean, it's a modest effort, but it really is. I mean, we've stopped a couple of major projects. Mm-hmm. You know, we do exist in the real world, and it's not just the imagination.
And the recently got another parcel added to the river parks.
The G2 or the bow tie parcels. They're pretty significant, like 40 acres along the river. That's that's ultimately getting lands out of private hands into the public domain. This is what we do, you know, for real. And the cornfield is about to open. The cornfield's almost open in the next month.
Yeah.
And that took 10 years from the time we started that project till now. What a waste of time. No, I don't feel like that at all, actually.
Yeah, that whole landscape down there is really changed.
Yeah, you know, it's true. Well, yeah, it's the evolution of that land is—it's hardly over. You know, it's, you have to think of it in like, when you think of a 40-year artwork, you have to think of. You have to think of it as a. It's like a subway system, you know. Building a better river is like, you know, that's what we do. Is we build rivers, you know, and think how long it's taken to build a metro and other civic amenities. You know, that I think you have to judge them as a generational moves, because it really that is. I mean, you can't change. Oh, Kerouac has this great mysterious line, walking on water wasn't built in a day. If you had a name, that's, you should call this thing Walking on Water Wasn't Built in a Day. Or you could say, just call it, I don't know if you have titles or so, or just call it Walking on Water. That's good.
Well, I want to thank you very much for your time, and also for all the hard work you've done to make the river what it is today and what it will be in the future.
Yeah,
so
thanks.
We really appreciate that. You're leaving a lasting mark in our community, and we really appreciate it. So thank you for your time.
Yeah, well, you guys are doing the real work. I get pats on the back. And I guess you guys get those too.
We're just recording it.
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks so much.
Yeah. A pleasure.